Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks to the IFEA for the invitation to this meeting. Thanks to the scientific moderator, and thanks to Dr. Gopi Krishna for the organization and the patience in supporting me in this lecture. We are talking today about the benefits of hydrophilic cements in endodontic practice, and this is a topic which I've covered with the help of a lot of people, which I will try and name at each time. First of all, the topics we are covering today, there will be a brief introduction on the properties of calcium silicate-based endodontic materials, and then there will be a part on the results of clinical trials, which we have conducted on the outcome of vital pulp therapy and root canal obturation undertaken with calcium silicate sealers. And then there will be some technical tips for the use of silicate cements, vital pulp therapy, and root canal perforations and treatments of the perforations of the pulp chamber. And also some tips on the single cone obturation with calcium silicate sealers. So everything basically began with MTA. And MTA is, as you all know, made of tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, and tricalcium aluminate, and other components. Not many people know that actually MTA was partially developed here at King's College London by Professor Torabinejad, which was a PhD student at the time, just and is, as you can see in this picture, is sitting looking at a microscope. And this image here is the dissertation of Professor Torabinejad, which at the moment actually sits in my office. So, by the way, at this very moment, I'm probably sitting exactly in the same place where Professor Torabinejad was sitting at the time. So it's been a long time since then. And when MTA came out, there was quite an enthusiasm about this because the product was launched with this claim, which was entirely true. So we could image in an experimental animal, for example, bone and periodontal ligament growing perfectly around that plug of MTA. And clearly, the objection from some people was, well, bone effectively can grow on anything. But what Professor Torabinejad and Professor Pitford found in this histologic experiment was effectively that this kind of response was more or less happening regularly with MTA, which didn't happen with other materials. And then there was an evolution of calcium silicate materials. This is, for example, Biodentin, which is again made of tricalcium silicate, dicalcium silicate, but also of calcium carbonate. And it's, so to speak, a much more carefully crafted product. So, how are these materials different from other dental materials which we use in the daily practice? The differences are probably summarized well in this slide from Professor Pierre Colonne, which I received quite a few years ago. And substantially, what you have here is the comparison between a glass ionomer cement, which is basically a gel of calcium polyalkanoate, aluminum, and salts, and MTA and Biodentin, which are instead a gel of hydrated calcium silicate and calcium hydroxide. So the difference basically between a glass ionomer and a calcium silicate cement is largely associated with the reaction that develops in this cement, and it's an hydrophilic cement in that the reaction with water is causing release of calcium hydroxide. So this is the property which, from a clinical perspective, we are probably more interested in. So these materials are able to create a very alkaline environment. So the other question to answer is, are these silicate materials bioactive? What does bioactive mean, particularly in the context of endodontics? The definition of bioactive is that this material through a biochemical and biophysical reaction with fluids leads to the formation of carbonated apatite crystals, which are obviously very important because they are one of the main components of the mineral phase of bone cementum. Clearly, there has been criticism to this statement, so we don't really know how bioactive these materials are in real life. So in this paper, for example, from Dr. Camilleri, Paul Lambrex, Barbara Mierbeck, and other authors, they found that actually in the few in vivo experiments, there was more formation of calcium carbonate than hydroxyapatite, which is obviously relevant because calcium carbonate is reabsorbable and it's not hydroxyapatite. So the question of how bioactive these materials are in vivo is partly open. Certainly in vitro, it has been proven time and time again that calcium silicate cements are bioactive. And then there is the last group of material, which is the calcium silicate sealers, which were added to the calcium silicate cements approximately 12 years ago. And this is a list of some of the most used calcium silicate sealers, and we can start with the endosequence, which comes with different names in America. In Europe, it's called TotalFill. And then we go down to the Endoseal, the BioRoot RCS from Septodont, and these other materials. They are all similar in a way, in that they all contain tricalcium silicate, but their chemistry is in reality quite different. So this is an example of the setting reaction of BioRoot, which is a calcium silicate sealer. And as you can see, it's a very similar reaction to the one of Biodentin we've seen before. And ideally, the step two of this phase should be the precipitation and deformation of hydroxyapatite. If you want to have a view of calcium-based sealers, calcium silicate sealers, you can read this review from Dr. Donnermeyer, Dr. Burklein, and Dr. Schaffer, which is actually very comprehensive. And basically, it summarizes the main properties of this sealer. On one hand, we have the big advantage of having a material which is, by all means, very effective in terms of antibacterial activity. On the other hand, we have some suspicion about the solubility of these materials, because the reaction is so long-lasting that the question was, do they remain dimensionally stable, as we need? Because clearly, if we use this material for a root filling, we don't want to create any voids at any point. And the answer to this question actually came from the work of Dr. Schaffer and Dr. Donnermeyer themselves, which proved in this paper, which was published on Journal of Endodontics in 2018, that actually the stability of BioRoot, for example, was quite good over a period of 6 months. This is a work which we have just published, and you can read it online because it's open access. And basically, it's an investigation on the antimicrobial effectiveness of calcium silicate sealers versus a multi-species biofilm, which we created in the lab. So this is a comparison of 4 sealers, actually. The TotalFill, which would be the American endosequence, the BioRoot RCS, which is another calcium silicate sealer, which are compared with AEH+, which, as everybody knows, is an epoxy resin-based sealer, and the TubliSeal, which is a well-known zinc oxide eugenol sealer. And the main aspect, the first aspect of this investigation, is the pH over time of these sealers. So the red line, in this case, is BioRoot, And you can see that Bayreuth stays very alkaline, around 11, 12, over a period of approximately 28 days. The dark line, the black line, is the total fill, so the endosequence, which remains also very alkaline for a week, and then drops a bit, going slightly down. The green line is the AH+, which starts to a certain alkaline level and then goes down quite sharply around 2 hours after the setting. And obviously the blue line is the tubulisil, which is a zinc oxide eugenol sealer and remains relatively acidic over time. And this is confirmed again by the experiment of Dr. Urban and Dr. Schaffer, which realized that the actual pH remains for a very long time at a very high, at a very alkaline level, particularly for Bayreuth. And another confirmation of this intense activity of Bayreuth is provided by this old experiment from Dr. Camilleri. At the time, the sealer was experimental. And you can see that there is a very intense release of calcium hydroxide from Bayreuth, which is quite superior to the one of the other sealers, which Dr. Camilleri tested, which are also bioactive sealer and also release quite a bit of calcium hydroxide. Basically, the release of calcium hydroxide is an indication of a very high reaction rate, and clearly this is an indication of bioactivity in general. So this is quite important because at the end of the day, we have materials, these sealers, which are able to penetrate quite deeply, for example, into the dentinal tubules. So these are confocal microscopic images of these sealers. This part here is the lumen of the canal. These are the tubules. This is the layer of the sealer. And obviously the sealer, in this case, tubulisil, is capable of penetrating quite deeply into the tubules. And the same is true for the AH+ and for the Bayreuth. Clearly, if we have an infected tooth within these dentinal tubules, we are going to have a biofilm of bacteria, which, as we know, can penetrate quite deeply, up to 500 microns into the tubules, sometimes more. So we have a material which does penetrate into the tubules quite deeply. And if bacteria are present into the tubules, the high pH, which is created by a calcium silicate sealer, should be able to kill this bacteria. So this is the principle behind the use of a calcium silicate sealer in this particular context. And this is confirmed by this other part of the experiment, which is basically the killing of the bacteria grown inside the root canal of an extracted tooth. And you can see these images, the Bayreuth RCS is killing more bacteria than the others. These are red cells, which indicate cells which are dead. And it's obvious that this particular sealer and also the total feed, they kill a bit more bacteria than the others. The last property, which is important to remember, is how these materials react with heat. So there is the general idea that we don't need to use these calcium silicate sealers in combination with warm techniques. And that's an important point. Although we need to be careful in evaluating this laboratory data, for example, in this experiment from Dr. Camilleri, it was also found that AH+ is altered by heat. So the thickness of the film of the AH+ increases with heat. Nonetheless, AH+ has been used for many, many years very successfully as a sealer in combination with warm condensation. So any experiment we are making is identifying properties of the materials which at some point will need to be tested clinically. And we'll see the clinical trials involved in this later. So the first message we need to remember from this first part of the lecture is that these particular sealers have a stronger and longer lasting antibacterial effect compared with zinc oxide eugenol sealers and resin-based sealers. This is associated with the high pH established by the calcium silicate materials. Particularly, BioRoot had a longer lasting increase of the pH compared with TotalFill. And also, this pH increase was longer lasting also in comparison with other sealers in the experiment of Dr. Donnermeyer and his colleagues. And this probably partially explains the higher level of bacterial killing which we observed with BioRoot. So these materials have been used over the years in many different ways for indirect pulp capping, direct pulp capping, pulpotomy, apexification, obturation of root canals, filling of perforations, retrofillings. This is an example of a couple of perforation repairs. You can see this particular tooth has got two radiolucencies on the buccal roots, but also a small screw post here, which is associated with this small lesion of the furcation and possibly with the extrusion of some material here. So this is how I fill the perforation using Biodentin. Biodentin is clearly a material which we use in a different way compared to other materials. And so Biodentin is prepared like this. You place your capsule and open it, so the powder is contained into the capsule. And then you need to add very precisely 5 drops of the liquid, which is calcium chloride. It's very important because if the proportion is not respected very strictly, it doesn't work. So 5 drops of the liquid, and then you vibrate into your amalgamator, which also needs to have the appropriate setting, because the setting for the Biodentin vibration is basically normally the highest one of your machine, the one with some kind of sinusoidal effect. So you need to test it and see if it works. 30 seconds is the vibration, so these numbers are important to remember. 5 drops of liquid, 30 second vibrations using the highest setting of your machine. And at this point, the Biodentin is ready to be used. So when you remove it, you can see that my nurse, at this time, he can't remove the capsule. So when you remove it from the amalgamator, it needs to have this particular aspect here. It needs to be more or less like this. I like to deliver the Biodentin using a plugger. Some people use a gun. I'm not very friendly with the guns, which they get blocked very easily. And this is the image of the filling of the perforation using Biodentin. So it's not that before the calcium silicate cements, we were not able to repair perforations. The difference in the repair of perforations which we can obtain using calcium silicate cements is that they are much more reproducible. So we tend to obtain good results more or less every time. Whereas in the past, when we used, let's say, glass ionomers or other materials, it wasn't as predictable. This is another example, perforation of in the attempt of the dentist to try and find the canal, which was a bit calcified. This is the filling of the perforation and then the filling of the canal. And this is the result at 2 years. The reproducibility of these results has been described very well in this paper of 2015 from Dr. Gorni and Galliani and their colleagues. And they found that in approximately 110 perforations they managed to follow for a few years, they had a very high success rate with the 9 or 10%, 8% failure rate, and the failure rate which was largely associated with large perforations. Also, we use calcium silicate cements in apical surgery. We use calcium silicate cements in the treatment of open apices and resorptions. And basically, we will cover now the clinical trials we have run on vital pulp treatment and root canal treatments using calcium silicate materials. Most of these trials are run using combeam CT for the assessment of the outcome. It is worth mentioning the reason why we use combeam CT. And the reason is largely this particular study, which was basically an histologic study on cadavers, in which we tried to demonstrate, and we effectively demonstrated, that the images we were getting using combeam CT, which were showing a radiolucency, were effectively associated with histologic images of granulomas or cysts. And the same was not happening with periapical radiographs. So we realized that the periapical radiographs are effectively much less sensitive than the combeam CT in the assessment of the presence of granulomas and cysts in a cadaver. And this is important because at the end of the day, the sensitivity in detecting success or failure of a root canal is relevant. For example, if we compare these two clinical trials, which were run by the same operator. So we are comparing here the same dentist doing root canals in 2010 using ProTaper Universal and in 2018 using ProTaper Next and the different infection control protocol. If we rely on the periapical radiographs, it looks like this dentist hasn't made any progress in 10 years. His success rate is basically the same. If we look at this graph, the periapical radiographs show a success rate of 87% in 2010 and 89% in 2020. Whereas if you look at the scans, it's a very different picture, because the real success rate was 62% in 2010, and it grew up to 78% in 2020. There is another paper which is confirming these results, and is the paper from Dr. Kruse and Dr. Kirkevan and their colleagues. And basically, they looked not just at primary lesions. They looked also at radiolucencies in teeth which were endodontically treated. And they found that in the virgin teeth, effectively, the effectiveness of the combeam CT was almost 100%. They found, though, some false positives, let's say, in the case of teeth which had been already endodontically treated. So there were some cases, 19% of the cases, in which the radiologist identified a radiolucency which wasn't associated with disease. Now, this doesn't mean anything in terms of assessment of the outcome of a treatment, because the assessment of the outcome of the treatment is done only by comparing two radiographs, the one at the beginning and the recall one. Because this image is just a snapshot of a root canal, which may be done 1 year ago, and maybe 1 year ago this radiolucency had a 10 millimeters or a 10 centimeters size. And then now it's healing, even if it's still there as a radiolucency. So the conclusion is that we need to be careful in saying that the COMIBCT doesn't work. It does work, because we do not assess radiographically the outcome of any treatment without a baseline radiograph taken with the same technique. And even if we have this radiograph, the symptoms also tells us what we need to do. This concept sometimes is difficult to explain, but just to compare what we are looking at, let's think for a second that we are not talking about root canals, we are talking about cancer. So this is a patient with the cancer of the lung. It doesn't show anything in a plain chest X-ray, because the chest X-ray doesn't show it. But if we take a scan, which will be our COMIBCT, we do see the cancer there. And then 1 year later, after the treatment, it looks like this gentleman has nothing, because it had nothing at the beginning and nothing at the end. But then, if we take a scan, we still see something there. So there is some residual lesion, which may be a fibrous tissue, maybe an artifact, maybe a small amount of cancer, but certainly we don't want our patient to be assessed for the treatment of the cancer using an X-ray that doesn't show anything at the beginning or at the end. This is exactly what happens with COMIBCT and periapical radiographs. For example, in this radiograph, we have a patient that has got tenderness on biting, tenderness to percussion on the 4, on the 6, and on the 7. We don't see any radiolucency here. We can't do any vitality test on the two abutments of the bridge because the two abutments of the bridge have got crowns. So we take another radiograph on a different angle and still we can't see anything. But with the scan, we can clearly see that there is a very large buccal area of inflammation around the buccal roots of the 6. There is also some decay or resorption on the 7. There is a radiolucency on the palatal root of the 6. And the radiolucency on the premolar. So our students does the treatment. And then 1 year later, we check if the treatment of this teeth has been successful or not. But if we take a periapical radiograph, we didn't see anything at the beginning, and we don't see anything at the end. So we need another scan, which actually shows that we have a reduction of the size of the radiolucency, which is still in need of improving. Whereas the 5 has healed completely. This is another example. It's a root canal treatment of an upper 6. There is a radiolucency here. 1 year later, it looks like it's completely healed. But actually, if we compare the scan at baseline and at 1 year, clearly the radiolucency hasn't healed completely. That's another example. We have a mesial root here, which doesn't show any evidence of any pathology, neither in the PA or in the scan. But 1 year later, after the treatment, the student has managed to separate a file here. And this is the classical situation where we say, Well, you see, you've cleaned the canal well. Even if you separated the file, it still healed. Actually, it didn't heal. As you can see, the radiolucency has developed. So there was no radiolucency here, and there is one radiolucency now, which is totally invisible here. And finally, we have a situation like this one with no obvious pathology at the beginning, no obvious pathology at the end, but a very obvious radiolucency in the scan at baseline, which gets much bigger 1 year later. This crown was done by the referring dentist. So in this case, we have missed an entire evolution of this pathology, and this radiolucency was there and has grown up bigger. So if you are interested in this topic, we have published this small editorial on AIJ to describe these particular aspects of the use of combimicity. So the second message from this lecture is that actually combimicity is by far the most sensitive technique for the assessment of the outcome of vital pulp and root canal treatments. There are two separate cadaver studies proving this. One study proving that CBCT is far better than PAs in this respect. And also, there is no evidence at all that combimCT is associated with more false positive in detections of failures compared to periapical radiographs, because this comparison has never been made. So let's see what we learn from this type of trials on the use of calcium silicate cements. This is the first study we published with Dr. Banerjee and Dr. Hashem, and basically it's an assessment on the effect of calcium silicate cement, biodentin, versus Fuginine in the treatment of cases of reversible pulpitis in which we undertake an indirect pulp capping. So CaResolve was used to remove the decay in a very minimally invasive fashion. So CaResolve, as you know, it's a mixture of sodium hypochlorite and some amino acids, which help removing the caries-affected dentin. We split the teeth presenting with the reversible pulpitis in teeth with mild symptoms, let's say when the response to cold was lasting 2 or 3 seconds, and teeth in which the response to cold was lasting maybe a bit longer. And this is an example of one of these cases. We have a very large occlusal cavity here. 1 year later, everything seems to be fine. And then we took a scan at baseline, and this particular scan wasn't checked by us or by Dr. Hashem, which was doing the treatments. It was only checked by the radiologist. So we didn't know that this particular tooth already had the radiolucency here. We treated with the indirect pulp cap, and 1 year later, the radiolucency is gone. So in this case, the removal of the decay, the antibacterial effect of our procedures was enough in ensuring the healing of a small periapical radiolucency which was present at baseline. This is the opposite situation. If we look at the periapical radiograph at baseline and 1 year, we don't have any evidence of any pathology, and there is no pathology at baseline in the scan. But actually, 1 year later, we can see that two small radiolucencies have developed on both the buccal roots. So in this case, the pulp capping has failed. The result was that those teeth which had a radiolucency already in the CBCT scan, which we didn't know because we didn't look at it, actually failed much more than the ones which didn't have a radiolucency, which is something that may be useful. For example, if you have a patient which is having symptoms which are basically borderline reversible, irreversible pulpitis. If you take a scan, you can see that there is a small radiolucency. You are probably more likely to undertake a root canal treatment because you know that that particular situation is more likely to fail, or at least you can tell the patient. This doesn't mean that I'm suggesting to take a scan of all the indirect pulp cuppings you are using. It's just one further aid you can possibly use. As for the materials, there was a difference between biodentin and Fuginine, whereas the vast majority of the failures were in the Fuginine group, actually. So the third message from this lecture is actually that if you want to treat an irreversible pulpitis case, the use of calcium silicate sealer cement is more indicated than the use of a glass ionomer cement. The second study we did is basically an assessment of the use of MTA in comparing two different techniques for the removal of decay. So what we did, we compared the minimal invasive technique in which we decided to use a microscope, we decided to use Carisol, versus another technique, which is the conventional technique, which is used by most dentists, that is using rotary bursts up to a level of leathery dentin. So in this case, we had 100 restorations placed in 86 patients. And one group in which we use rotary bursts and no magnification, and the second group in which we used the Carisol and the microscope. So we called 85 teeth in total, and the failure rate of the minimal invasive group was 10%, whereas the failure rate of the conventional removal was 26%. So it was a very significant difference. And also we found that the premolars were failing much more than the molars. And also there were more cases of irreversible pulpitis in the conventional excavation group, although there wasn't a statistical significant difference. The results at 2 years substantially confirmed this data. And this is an example of a premolar which developed the radiolucency 1 year later. The reason why this happens in the premolars is a bit difficult to explain, possibly because the premolar has got a smaller pulp, maybe less capacity of defending itself from insults coming from outside, because the size of the crown of the molar is smaller, so if you got a minimal leakage here, it will reach the pulp more easily. This is an example of a successful case. Instead, large cavity on a low R6. The CBCT scan at baseline doesn't show any radiolucency, and the CBCT scan at 1 year also doesn't show any radiolucency. This is the very large restoration on this particular six, which at 1 year clearly shows the need for crowning this tooth. One other interesting aspect of this study is that if we excluded the patients which we included in the study and were having two teeth treated, there was about 14 teeth in 7 patients out of 85 which were in basically in the same patient, so 2 teeth per patient rather than 1 teeth per patient. And that's an interesting result because when we did a review of our trials, we excluded at some point the patients that had 2 teeth treated. If you do this with this particular trial, the result is surprising because the only factor which determines the outcome is the size of the cavity. So if you exclude the patients with two teeth treated, so if you create a sample which is, if you want to, so to speak, more homogeneous, without any bias associated with the patient, the material is irrelevant. What is relevant is the size of the cavity. If you have a cavity with two or three walls missing, then your failure rate is six times higher. And obviously, there is a reason for that. The bigger the cavity, the more easy is the leakage of bacteria inside the cavity itself, the more difficult is to undertake a direct restoration, the higher the chances of failure. This is the example. The students didn't have any problem in undertaking this large buccal restoration on the six. Whereas the other student had a problem in controlling the margin in the distal box of this upper seven, hence the failure. Another problem we have with all these procedures, indirect pulp cupping, pulpotomies, is the potential for the calcification of the pulp, which probably hasn't been investigated very thoroughly so far, because we know what happens with the calcification of the pulp in trauma cases. But in these particular cases of removal of decay, we don't really know very much. In this seven, for example, at 1 year, we already have quite a significant shrinkage of the pulp chamber there. So the fourth message from this lecture is that indirect pulp cupping assessed by CBCT are more effective if you use carisol and magnification. We need to be careful in the indirect pulp cupping of premolars with irreversible pulpitis. We may need to consider sometimes a root canal because there is a much higher failure rate in premolars. And also, it's important to remember that the walls of the cavity are important. So a cavity with two or three walls missing is far, far more likely to fail than a cavity which is an occlusal cavity, for example. So in that case, we may wish sometimes to go towards a root canal. Direct pulp cupping is another use of calcium silicate cements. We can quote the study from Dr. Kunzina, which found that MTA was more effective than calcium hydroxide in this 36-month study, with a success rate of 85% versus 52%. And then there is the chapter which is now developing more and more, one would say, on the pulpotomy in the treatment of irreversible pulpitis. We are used to deal with cases like this simply with a root canal. That's our normal approach. But what if this other approach, which has been known for many years, was better? Clearly, there is a view for attempting, not attempting pulpotomy and going straight into the root canal, which is the view that we have taken for many years for good reasons in a way, because we don't know exactly what's the histopathological state of the pulp. The works from Seltzer, Dammer, and Gopikrishna have highlighted this. And also there is this element of a severe pulp inflammation, which is in a confined space. So that particular inflammation easily leads to necrosis. It is also difficult to highlight which is the tissue which is infected and the tissue which is not infected. On the other hand, if we attempt vital pulp therapy with these teeth, we are in a situation which is more favorable, because root canal treatment, as we all know, is a procedure which may include procedural mistakes at any time. The procedure of the root canal treatment is expensive, is time-consuming, more destructive than the pulpotomy in general. And also, we know that in the vast majority of the cases, at the end of the day, if it's an irreversible pulpitis, those bacteria will not be penetrating very deeply inside the canals. They will be largely confined within the coronal pulp. And then there are all sorts of approaches. This, for example, is a study from Dr. Asghari, which was published on Journal of Endodontics a couple of years ago, in which actually some cases of irreversible pulpitis were treated in an even more conservative fashion. This is a very extraordinary study from many aspects, because you see that they treated cases of irreversible pulpitis with indirect pulp cup, 13 cases. And they also treated with direct pulp cup some cases with irreversible pulpitis and with partial pulpotomy. And apparently, there's no difference in outcome, which is exactly the opposite of what we all think, because we assume that if we do that, the patient is going to be in an unbearable pain, which seems not to have happened in this study. So there are aspects which we still need to understand, because if we compare the results of Dr. Asghari, 90% success at 1 year of an indirect pulp cup in a tooth with irreversible pulpitis, with the results of Lars Bjørndalen 2010 and 2017, where actually the success rate was 30% at 1 year and 10% at 5 years, clearly there is something that we need to reconcile here and understand what's happening in these studies. The material use was different, but does the material justify such a huge imbalance? But going into the more accepted treatment, which is the pulpotomy for irreversible pulpitis, obviously we know from Dr. Ricucci's work, for example, that there is some histologic evidence that an irreversible pulpitis sort of correlate with a diffuse inflammation of the coronal pulp and with a relatively less inflamed inflammation of the canals. So this is what we base our decision to undertake a pulpotomy. And clearly, this systematic review from Kushley 2019 shows that the results are quite positive, with a 36-month survival of the pulp of 88%. Although the vast majority of the cases were collected in one study, the one from Dr. Asghari. So this is a small film which is going to show the steps necessary for a full pulpotomy. You isolate your tooth with your rubber dam. You disinfect the tooth with 5% sodium hypochlorite, which is very important because this procedure is largely based on the avoidance of infection. Then you remove your decay. Then you outline your access cavity. You disinfect your access cavity with 5% sodium hypochlorite. You penetrate into the pulp chamber. Then you enlarge the access and remove completely the roof of the pulp chamber. This is a film that was prepared by Dr. Fadi Jarad and Sondo Salbadri for a clinical trial we are running. So at this point, you are ready to disinfect the pulp chamber again with 5% sodium hypochlorite. And you remove the coronal pulp tissue. Personally, I use only around high-speed burr. I never use excavators because I try and avoid lacerating the pulp. At this point, we can identify the orifices, which may be the most difficult part, because there is an MB2 orifice, for example, in an upper molar to identify. And then we stop the bleeding. the timing for the stopping of the bleeding may be 2, 5, 10 minutes. There is no real agreement on this. So once we have stopped with the cotton pellet and sodium hypochlorite the bleeding, we are ready to place the biodentin in the orifices of the canals. What we are aiming for is the creation of a 3 millimeter layer of biodentin on the floor of the pulp chamber. And once we've done that, we need to wait 12 minutes for the setting, the initial settings of the biodentin. And then we are ready for the restoration. Personally, I prefer to place a base of glass ionomer. Clearly, there will be some chemical interaction at the surface of these two materials because one is acidic and the other one is largely alkaline. But the placement of a direct composite without a base of glass ionomer would be probably more damaging because the contraction of the composite might detach the biodentin. So I prefer to have a thin base of glass ionomer on top. And then you can layer your composite as Dr. Fadi Jarad is doing in this film. So it's a process which is largely empirical at the moment. So there are many aspects which haven't been standardized because we don't really know how relevant, for example, is the bleeding, how long is the bleeding time, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, what do we need to use to stop the bleeding? We use sodium hypochlorite, other operators may use a different technique. The compaction of the biodentin into the pulp chamber may be a bit difficult at times. If you have a pulp chamber like this one, for example, it's not the easiest of the jobs. So in this case, you may need to use a different technique instead of using your normal restorative instruments. You may need to use a plugger and gently plug the biodentin in the deepest part of the cavity. I really prefer to use the plugger most of the time rather than using a burnisher or a restorative instrument, because the endodontic plugger gives you the opportunity to avoid pushing too hard into the orifices of the canal. I personally think that if you compact the biodentin, in particular into the orifice of the canal, there might be a risk of calcification, considering the significant amount of calcium which this material is going to release. So it's better if you layer the biodentin on without invading the orifices of the canal. This is my personal impression. And after that, you obviously can complete with the burnisher once you've reached the 2 or 3 millimeters of thickness of the biodentin layer. This is a clinical case, so lower 6, large distal decay, placement of the rubber dam, disinfection with 5% sodium hypochlorite before you start with the excavation, control of the bleeding, so again 5% sodium hypochlorite. Clearly, the excavation of the decay needs to be thorough, so we are not aiming in this situation to leave any caries-affected dentin or any kind. So we go for white dentin, which is absolutely not soft by any means. Then we mix the biodentin, as we've seen before. We place the biodentin and we layer the glass ionomer and the composite. This is a 6-month radiograph, which already shows some reduction of the size of the mesial canals. This is an interesting study on pulpotomy from Dr. Kunert and José Poli de Figueiredo from the University of Rio Grande do Sul in Brazil. And this dentist, Dr. Kunert, collected a number of pulpotomies he had done over the years, namely 273 cases. And in 273 cases, he managed to follow these for up to 29 years. So these type of studies are really important because you have one single very expert operator which follows his own case. So this type of study gives you exactly the potential for a technique. So it tells you exactly what you can achieve with a certain technique. Clearly, it's a study over many years, and Dr. Kunert used calcium hydroxide. He didn't use MTA because it goes back in the years. It's a very interesting study, though, because it shows, for example, that at 1 year, the success rate was almost 90%, and then goes down to 83%, 81% at 3 years, and goes to 76%, 75% at 5 years, and the 10 years recall, of which Dr. Kunert has many, is associated with a success rate of 63%. But another probably more important factor is that he didn't find any difference in age groups. Clearly, if there was dentin bridge formation, the success was higher. But also, he found that teeth that had been covered with crowns had a much better success rate. You can see this survival curve. Basically, at 5 years, you've got 80% success, 10 years, 15 years, 80% success if you place a crown on this teeth. If you place simply a direct filling, the success rate goes down a lot. This is particularly true for the resin composite restorations. So this is something to think about because it tells again that the quality of the restoration must be relevant. And also this tells us that probably one of the reasons why we think we are doing a pulpotomy, that is avoiding the crown, is actually not particularly good, because if this is true, and there is no reason to believe that this is not true, most of these teeth which have these large, huge restorations do need a cuspal coverage with an indirect restoration at some point. Clearly, there are different results. These are the results at 2 years from Dr. Asghari, and the success rate is 79% for the root canal and 86% for the pulpotomy. So the last take-home message on the pulpotomy is that it is an interesting option, no question about it. We need a bit more information on the very long-term outcome of these procedures, probably in the comparison between root canal treatment and pulpotomy. Would be better to know a bit more on this. How many teeth do calcify? How difficult is the reintervention on these teeth? How many extractions? What is the cost of these interventions? The other question which needs answering is, do we really avoid the cuspal coverage in these molars because these teeth are largely molars after a pulpotomy, or these teeth are so broken down that they do need the cuspal coverage anyway? So the last part of our presentation is basically the use of single cone calcium silicate sealers for root canal obturation. And there is an interesting survey that was done by Dr. Bouquet and Dr. The other colleagues, Dr. Abou from the University of Paris, if I remember well. And they observed that calcium silicate sealers are very popular, in particular when people use calcium silicate sealers, the vast majority of the dentists use the calcium silicate sealers with a single cone technique. A smaller percentage use calcium silicate sealers also with a warm vertical condensation, even if they are not really particularly indicated for this. An equal proportion of dentists uses the lateral condensation with calcium silicate sealers and other sealers. Also, there is a difference in this survey between the specialists, so the specialists that are specialists in endodontics, they tend to use the single cone with the calcium silicate sealers, whereas the general dentist, they tend to use the single cone with also other sealers, whereas more specialists use the single cone also with the warm vertical condensation, whereas only a small number of general dentists do this. So what about retreatments? Because clearly retreatments and calcium silicate sealers is in a way the big question. A few years ago, I was quite surprised when one of my students went for a period of a few months in a university in America, and he came back telling us that in that particular university, the technique which the endodontists were taught was a calcium silicate sealer, and basically there was the assumptions in this university that once you've done your obturation with the calcium silicate sealer, you were not able to retreat, and if anything went wrong, they were going directly into surgical endodontics. And obviously this was a bit surprising. If this was the case, obviously it would be a limit, because we are depriving ourselves of an option for treatment of a patient, which doesn't seem to be particularly smart. So personally, this is how I use the single cone and calcium silicate sealer obturation. The only sealer I have used of this type is the Bioroot, so I can't comment very much on the technique with other sealers, let's say Endosequence or others. But this is what I do with Bioroot, which doesn't mean that it's the only way you can use it. This is just the way I use it. And certainly I don't pretend to be a particular expert in single cone obturations, because I've used it for a couple of years and my main technique remains warm vertical. So what I do is this. I try the master point after I've done my preparation, take the x-ray, and then I place the sealer on the gutta-percha point, and I place the sealer inside the canal with the gutta-percha point or with the paper point. Then I place the GP point inside the canal and cut the GP point using a cordless pack device. So I don't do any compaction, I don't do any compression of any kind. I simply cut the GP point and I measure the level of the cut considering the size of the canal. So if I got a palatal canal of an upper six, which is very wide coronally, clearly I cut it a bit more apically, so that after this, I can gently plug with a plugger so that I obtain a better adaptation of the GP point to the apical and middle portion of the canal. And then I fill the coronal part using a composite, with a composite gun, with a centric syringe, or a glass ionomer, like I've done in this particular case. I use this technique for a reason. So what I'm doing is exactly this. I try the GP point so that it stays 1 millimeters from the apex. Then I mix the Bioroot. Bioroot is the dosage would be 5 drops and 1 scoop of powder, but I mean, it's a sealer, and similar to many zinc oxide eugenol sealers in this respect. So you can play a bit with the consistency. So if you have an apex which is a bit larger, then you can make it a bit more consistent, as I'm doing in this case. If the apex is small, you can keep it more fluid. But the reason why I use this technique, rather than an injection with a syringe of the sealer inside the canal, is that at the end of the day, these sealers are bioactive only if they are in contact with water. So there is no point having a huge amount of sealer in the coronal or in the middle portion of the canal, because there is no water which is supposed to be in a root canal treated tooth in the middle part of the canal or in the coronal part of the canal. Because if you have water, so if you have fluid in that particular part of the canal, clearly you are in a situation of coronal leakage and your restoration is deemed to fail anyway. So the fact that you have an antibacterial agent coronally doesn't really help. With this particular technique, you push quite a bit of the sealer towards the apex, leaving the coronal part of the canal relatively occupied by gutta-percha, and in this way, your retreatment is easier. And I don't think that the technique you've just seen is any more difficult to remove. That gutta-percha is no more difficult to remove than this one, which is basically AH plus and gutta-percha. So this is bioroot, this is AH plus. They are similar in a way. I don't see why I should have any problem in removing a GP point from the middle of the canal. And then obviously I will have to struggle a bit in the apical portion if there is a bit more sealer there. But at least I've got quite a lot of space to access the apex for the retreatment. This is a root filling with a single cone bioroot in an upper seven. This is the X-ray from the dentist. This is another X-ray I've taken, and you can see that actually the distal root is very curved here. You can see that the distal root makes a kind of hook at this point. So, in this case, I place the sealer. The GP point. And this is the final aspect of the obturation. It doesn't look as good as the warm condensation techniques, but it still looks good. And there is no void there. We may miss the odd lateral canal. That's something that we see clearly more often with the thermoplasticized GP. This is a recurrent canal, for example. But in terms of voids, I don't think that this technique leaves any voids in the canal if it is used correctly. There is an aspect of radiopacity, obviously, endosequence, for example, and bioroot, this is from Dr. Camilleri's work, are a bit more radiopaque than other sealers, but certainly they won't be as radiopaque as thermoplasticized GP. This is a comparison between a single cone obturation with bioroot. You can see that there is some extrusion of sealer here, but it's barely visible. Whereas what happens at the apex with AH plus is clearly evident. But when you have a very infected canal, like this one, for example, is two treatments of an upper five with a large radiolucency and an upper six with the radiolucency on the distal root and the palatal root. And if you want to do this kind of case in one visit, I tend to use bioroot, because I rely very much on the antibacterial activity of this material. But ultimately, what are the clinical data which we have available on these particular sealers? Well, there is some study on the pain, for example. Dr. Granwhite from Lithuania, and his colleagues studied this, made this comparison between AH plus and BioRoot, actually total fill, and they didn't find any difference in postoperative pain. There is this study from Dr. Chybovsky on endosequence, so it's a 10-year retrospective study, 7-year retrospective study, and they had a good success rate, around 90%. We have just published this, which is, to my knowledge, the first clinical trial comparing calcium silicate sealer BioRoot versus AH plus and warm vertical condensation. It is non-randomized, so there are all the limits of a non-randomized trial. Clearly, the operator may have chosen one particular sealer, as I do with BioRoot, in a more difficult case, a more challenging case. So there are limits, but it's still something that gives you an idea of what you can achieve with the two techniques. So these root canals were undertaken by our specialist trainees. So this is a BioRoot case with a large radiolucency. And there is, as you can see, evidence of healing on the mesial root, on the distal root. This is another case from another student. Unfortunately, I forgot the names of the authors of these root canals, apologies. And this is the mesiobuccal root with a good healing. Distobuccal root, also with a good healing. In total, basically, we treated something like 125 teeth. Of these, we managed to recall 51 treated with AH plus and 53 treated with BioRoot. So a good recall rate altogether. The overall success rate was around 90% with PA and 83% with CBCT. As you can see, there's no real difference in failure rate between AH plus, warm vertical, and BioRoot single cone. So if we wanted to use these numbers as a base, for example, for a randomized trial, we would need hundreds of teeth, I don't know, 600 teeth in per group to try and find a difference. So it is extremely unlikely that you will find any difference between these two techniques. So the conclusion of this part is that at the end of the day, a single cone obturation with calcium silicate sealer has, as much as we can tell, a success rate which is comparable to that of an epoxy resin sealer. The single cone obturation with BioRoot can be managed effectively to limit the voids in the coronal part of the canal, even in large canals. Clearly, we will not be able to fill the same number of lateral canals because we are not applying any pressure in this case. But is this necessarily a bad thing? Probably not, no? Because we don't know exactly how relevant is the injection of lateral canals with sealer for the success. Also, if you don't apply any pressure, in theory, you are less likely to create cracks into the roots. So that could be another positive point. And the final conclusions of this lecture is that at the end of the day, we know that calcium silicate cements are the material of choice if you want to present the pulp vitality when we do an indirect pulp cupping. We can use calcium silicate sealers and single cone quite successfully for root canal obturations. These type of obturations are easy to retreat. Calcium silicate cements are also the material of choice for direct pulp cupping and pulpotomy. And at the end of the day, we need a bit more randomized trial to understand what is happening, particularly with the pulpotomy in the long term. Also, we need to remember that for the future, if we need to plan clinical trials to assess and compare different techniques in endodontics and vital pulp treatment, it would be wise to use CONBIM CT, because this would help us in finding the differences which are really present between the different groups. And with this, I thank you all for the attention, and I'm ready to take questions. Thanks very much.